Good morning, folks. If y'all want to get seated, we're going to try to go ahead and get started here so we can keep this morning rolling as smooth as possible. My name is Troy Smith. I'm a district sales manager for Eastern Iowa here. I cover Benton, Johnson, and Linn County, just west of here. I've been with the company for just a few months. And I wanted to take this time once again just to extend our thanks to each and every one of you for attending this event this morning. You know, we understand that time is of value, and we do appreciate you taking the time to come spend some time with us. And hopefully you're going to get some value out of what you're hearing today, experiencing here today in the tent. And hopefully it's something that will be of value to you when you go back to your own operation and help you with your own business. So again, thank you so much. Without you, we wouldn't be here today doing this in this in a tent like this. So again, thank you so much. We really, really do appreciate it. But one thing I wanted to hit on here is I've only been with the company a really short time here. But what you see and are experiencing here today is really what brought me and drew me to the company. In all my years in this industry, in the seed business, I can truly say I've never been with a company who spends so much time, pays so much attention to detail to their customers that Wyffels does. And, you know, it's a brand image that we're portraying. Hopefully you'll see that and experience that a little bit here today. But again, it means a lot to us as employees, and we hope that you're experiencing a little bit about the brand awareness and what Wyffels really stands for as a brand. As we're moving on here, our next featured speaker certainly has some dedication. Just learned this morning that I believe he had an accident here a week ago, Jay, and broke his hip. So we certainly want to extend a huge thank you to him for still making it here today. He's got a busy event. I think he's got four other speeches this afternoon. But for those of you that don't know him, Dr. Jay Lehr, he's a graduate of Princeton University. He's got over five decades of experience in the agricultural economic side of the world. And we really appreciate Jay taking some time to spend some time with us this morning. He's going to bring some valuable information to each and all of you. So with that said, you know, we want to express, you know, how much of a cheerleader Jay is for the agricultural world. And with that, we want to share a little video of Jay getting off the streets of San Francisco off his airplane.
Hi there. I bet you're wondering what I'm doing in San Francisco. I'm here to tell people about fertilizer.
It's a story I love to tell about what fertilizer is and why we use it and how we're just recycling it and how the farmer is the best land conservationist. I mean, this is probably going to be one of the most exciting cab rides you're going to have all day. And I'll just keep you entertained from here right on into the city of San Francisco. Because you know, there are 2 billion people on the earth today that are undernourished, and there'll be 2 billion more people in the next 40 years. And soccer fields that we would have had to plow down. You know, they talk about urban sprawl. You know, the city's moving out. Heck, we'd have rural sprawl if it wasn't for fertilizers. What a great ride. Well, thank you. I bet you might be wondering why I'm here in San Francisco. Well, I'm here in San Francisco to tell people about fertilizer and the importance of agriculture in America.
So I'm walking down the street somewhere outside of San Francisco. Tomorrow I'll be in another town. There's at least one coffee bar for every single couple. There's at least a couple in this place. Strange the things you notice when the walls are closing in.
Ever wonder why the grass is so green? Nitrogen and phosphorus. Most people don't understand farming. I'll bet there are people here who think the dog poop does it all.
There's no way out of here. Here is where I live, and so I guess that.
Do they use regular fertilizer on those farms? Do you know that the skeletons of these fish make the phosphate fertilizer that make your greens?
You don't speak a lot of English, I know that.
Do you know where that's grown?
Years ago I told you how I loved to be alone. These days I'd be perjuring myself. So where can I find some?
And because of fertilizers, we've tripled our yields the last 40 years. I work in agriculture. Do you know what fertilizer is? You ever wonder why the grass is so green? Because we fertilize it. Grass would turn brown and shrivel up if people didn't put nitrogen and potassium and phosphorus on it. You got to see the corn the Indians ate. You wouldn't have eaten it. Do you know what fertilizer is? I'm a scientist. I'm an educator. I'm going to tell you something about that hacky sack you don't know. It's filled with beans, and the beans were grown with fertilizer. People just don't understand that. Did you know what fertilizer was?
Now I know I'm lost somewhere outside of San Francisco.
You ever wonder why the grass is so green? Everywhere I go, I can't stop talking about fertilizer. It's just fun to be in a business that creates this kind of beauty and food for our table. Did you know that they'd have to plow Golden Gate Park if it wasn't for the fertilizer that farmers use? Did you ever think without fertilizer, these flowers wouldn't be near as pretty as they are? If it wasn't for the fertilizer industry that can grow so much more corn out in fields, 3 times more in the last 40 years than they did in 1960. Do you know that? I always think about that when I'm sitting in a park, watching the grass. Think about what a great job the farmers do to make it possible to get so much wonderful food at a low cost. People don't appreciate farmers anymore and the fertilizer industry. You know what a part petroleum is? I know you don't, but I'm going to tell you, and I'll bet you if I called you in 5 years, you'd remember. I'm here spreading the good word about fertilizer. Sunshine and rain and fertilizer is what grows our wonderful food here in San Francisco. Well, thanks. Nice talking to you. Okay.
Here is where I live, and so I guess that means the carrot's gonna dangle for at least another year.
You come here often?
Thank you and good afternoon. It is a pleasure to be here with all of you in Wyffels Seeds. A funny thing happened to me on the way to Iowa. I am wasn't mentioned in my introduction, but I am I'll be 77 on September 11th, and I'm now ranked 7th in the world in the Ironman triathlon event. I've done Hawaii 9 times, and 7th sounds really good until you find out there are only 8 people in the world in my age group. But I train a lot. I ride a bicycle about 6,000 miles a year, training for racing events. And last weekend, I tried to get in 200 miles. I rode 100 miles on Saturday, the 29th of July. My wife was out of town, and then she joined me for another long ride on Sunday, the 30th of June, and we ran into some road construction, and there was a gravel road and exposed manhole cover, and I swerved amidst the manhole and hit a curb and went down on a cement sidewalk and broke my right hip in 3 places. So they took me to the hospital on Monday night, the 1st of July. They put a couple nails in my hip to keep the bone in one place. And then a couple days later in the hospital, the doctor explained to me that I wouldn't be able to travel for 4 weeks. And I laughed at him and I said, gee, I got to be in Iowa in 5 days. He said, that's impossible. I said, tell me, doctor, how many Ironman triathletes have you operated on? I've done the event 14 times. He said, none. I said, well, I'll be in Iowa in 5 days. And here I am with really no difficulty at all and an exciting day. And I am going to give 4 different talks this very day in Iowa. And they'll all be exciting because it's one of my favorite states. I probably have not been away from Iowa a single year in the last 15 lecturing to farm groups. Been in agriculture my whole life in areas of ag economics, water supply, environment, energy, and agronomy. Probably give about 40 different talks relating to it. In the course of any 3-year period, I hit all 50 states in the United States. Every single year, I spend at least 3 weeks out of the country studying agriculture in other countries. Last year, my wife and I went to Singapore, Cambodia, Thailand, Vietnam, China, and Japan. This year we went to Sweden, Denmark, and Russia, studying agriculture and learning a lot about these countries in general. And I'm kind of the Johnny Appleseed of agriculture, and I travel around sharing my knowledge with all the groups I talk to. This is the golden age of agriculture. I can tell every one of you, number one, most of you are smart enough to use Wyffels seeds, and by the end of this talk, the rest of you will. And so I know you're smart farmers. You're going to be smarter at the end of this hour. And you can look forward to a career better than you've ever dreamed of. There has never been a day, and I'm at this for well over a half century, I've never been more optimistic, never been a time for us to look forward to a productive and economically successful career in feeding our state, our nation, and the world. We do have some problems, and I'm going to focus primarily on what those problems are here today and give you information on how to solve those problems. The primary problem in American agriculture is that we are not appreciated as farmers the way we were a half a century or more ago. Early in the 20th century, 26% of the country farmed. 50 or 60 years ago, we either lived on a farm, grandmother farmed, we knew somebody who farmed, and we knew that milk did not come from a cardboard carton in a grocery store, that a cow ate, pooped, and made milk. Today, young people and old people have no clue what you do on your farms, the advanced technology that has been spectacular for most of you and will be eventually for all of you. And the primary takeaway of my lecture today, and you might call it a recruiting lecture. I'm recruiting everybody in this room to become an emissary and advocator for agriculture. Now, Wyffels Seeds does a lot in promoting what they do and their great seeds and the different traits that their seeds have and why we will use less pesticides and have a greater resistance against vermin and other diseases, and why your corn is going to become healthier from the animals and even the people that eat it. But they can't do enough. And many of you belong to your state corn grower associations, and you think they're going to promote what you do, but they're not enough. We are facing a level of public ignorance, negativity, fear, scare, and lies relating to agriculture that must be overcome. It will not be overcome in a week, a month, or a year. I think it can be overcome in 10 years, but only if I can recruit everybody in this room to become an army of educators. I'm going to explain to you how, what your responsibility is, and information that you need to teach, to win back the hearts and minds of the public. Raise your hand right now in this room if you are not from Iowa. Okay, looks like 15 or 20% of you. So the vast majority are in Iowa. Let me tell you something about Iowa to make the problem local. In the 50 states I travel over a three-year period, in the dozen countries I travel to where people speak English, if I were to ask a word association question of anybody I talk to, and I say, what is the first word you think of when I say the word Iowa? 100% of them will give me one of two answers, corn or farming. Everybody in the country and most people in the world know that Iowa is the number one farm state. Within Iowa, you're number one in soy and corn and eggs and hogs. You're the number one state in the union. 85% of the land in Iowa is farmed. 10% of the best farmland in the world is considered to be in Iowa. 25% of the economic income of the state of Iowa comes from farming. One in six jobs is related to agriculture. And yet you would be amazed, or maybe you know, of the ignorance that exists in this state among its non-farming population about the importance of agriculture, the contribution of agriculture, because the non-farming community in the state does not learn anything about farming from you. I'll bet there aren't 20 people in this audience that spend any significant amount of time in a month talking about their farms to non-farmers. Number one, they assume people aren't interested. Number two, if they live in a rural community, they assume that everybody in a rural community knows about farming. Okay. Number one, if they live in a rural community, go to your drugstore and ask your druggist, an educated fellow or girl or woman, what fertilizer is, and you're likely to get a blank stare. Or they may say something like, oh, toxic byproducts of manufacturing used to make grains grow better. We got that answer more than any in surveys in Washington and Chicago on the streets of affluent neighborhoods during lunch hour. People do not understand farming because all they know about it is what they read in the newspaper, magazines, radio, and TV, and you read and hear and see those things, and how much of what you read, see, and hear about agriculture from the media is accurate. Very, very little of it. And so what does the public know about farming? Well, they think you're all farming grandfather's farm. How many of you are using some form of precision agriculture? A GPS, a rotosteer? Raise your hand if you're raising some. More than half of you. How many of you are using a genetically modified seed? More than half of you. How many of you are using some form of reduced tillage on your farm? More than half of you. The public knows nothing about these things that is positive. Everything they know about genetic modification and biotechnology is negative, and we'll go into that in detail in a while. So our problem is that we are not respected in Iowa or any other state of the union as we should be. We were once the heroes of America. We once did ride a white horse and a white hat and were the emblematic of what was good with America. Now anti-environment people, anti-agriculture people, anti-capitalist people who don't like modern agriculture, really don't like modern society, really don't like people for reasons I don't know, paint a negative picture of agriculture, the food we produce, food safety to the public who doesn't hear the positives from you, and so they grow up thinking agriculture isn't so good, we're not producing the best food, we're not caring humanely for our animals, we're not everything we are. So we have got to begin turning the corner. And the way we're going to do that is everybody in this room, starting today, is going to spend at least 2 hours a month. That's not much, people. 2 hours a month talking to your friends and neighbors, maybe your children at your dinner table who are getting wrong information in school about modern farming. Now, one thing, you think people are not interested. That was really the third problem of why you don't talk. You don't talk about your farms because you think people aren't interested. Or, as I said, in a rural community, you think they know. Well, let me tell you about the people in that movie you saw. You saw blank stares. Well, in a day and a half on the streets of San Francisco, I accosted 60 different people. Now, you laugh. You can only do that in San Francisco. You'd be arrested anywhere else, but in San Francisco, there's so many weirdos, you were just one of them. By the way, if you haven't been to San Francisco, that windy street in which I was sticking my head in people's car windows, that's called Lombard Street. And people wonder how long I was able to do that before the police came. And the answer was 20 minutes. And because I am an athlete, I did outrun them. They didn't catch them. But the thing you don't know about the movie is all of those blank stares turned into conversations. Those people, after the surprise of this stranger accosting them on the street wore off, they asked me questions about what I did and about farming and so on. They were actually interested. In 2 days, day and a half, I had 60 conversations. Only two were negative. There were two people that, you know, kind of blew me off. The other 58 engaged me in conversation, and the biggest problem was the hidden camera trying to get my eye so I'd, you know, move on to somebody else. But I'm an educator. The conversations were great. So the point I want you to go away with is people are interested in farming, and when I tell you stuff you already know to be sharing with people, you'll really catch the bug and enjoy talking about your farm. I want you to do it at your dinner table, at a social event, at a sporting event, wherever you are. Nobody really cares about your kid's soccer game. Come on. They really don't. Or your pathetic golf game. They really don't. They would love to hear about modern agriculture. Trust me. They really, really will. So your obligation from this day forward is 2 hours of every month of your time. Now it can be spent writing a letter to a newspaper that wrote a stupid wrong article. Maybe volunteering to teach for 30 minutes at your kid's school. I find most teachers are delighted to have somebody come in and talk about what they do in the natural science area of agriculture. So you won't have trouble. But the easiest way to get in your 24 hours a month, if you figured out the arithmetic of 2 times 12 is 24 hours, is to have an open house on your farm some weekend between planting and harvesting. Everybody in Iowa needs to visit a farm. Half the people in Iowa don't even like agriculture. They're almost embarrassed that agriculture is so important to your economy. You're a very weird, strange farm state. You're liberal. There are no other liberal farm states. All the other states have it right. So we've got an uphill battle here. The rest of this country would be shocked at what I'm saying, would be absolutely amazed that Iowa is what Iowa is. So we have a job to do, and the job spreads beyond our state borders throughout the whole country. We have got to set the country right on what agriculture is about. If we are, and we are, we will experience the golden age of agriculture. The prices may not stay up where they are, but they're not going to drop to where it's going to hurt. Are you going to make a lot of money in future years? The answer is yes if you're a good businessman, and no if you're not. Agriculture is about risk management. Know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. You know that song, Kenny Rogers and the Gambler. All businesses are risk management. I always like to say that agriculture is the riskiest business in America, with the exception of every other business in America. There are no businesses that are risk-free. Anyone who runs a business, which a farm is, An entrepreneur has risk and has to understand it. Farming is no better or no worse. Right now, our future is bright because the world needs our food more than ever. We've got 2 billion people, as I mentioned in the film, that are undernourished. We have got 2 billion more people that will be on the planet by 2060, close to 9 billion, that need to be fed. We'll do it, but it's a big job. We can't do it without genetic modification. We can't do it without precision agriculture. We can't do it without reduced tillage, but we can and we will do it. The population of the Earth will stop growing probably around 2060 and then begin to decline by the end of the century. We are the only country holding our own with a stable birth rate close to 2.1. Every other developed country in the world is now losing population except for immigration. You need a birth rate of 2.1 to hold your own. That's about where we are, maybe slightly below. All other developed countries are more in the range of 1.6 to 1.8. Japan and Russia are 1.2. They're going to have major economic problems in the coming years because of a declining population. We don't have to worry about that, you know, for a while. So for the next 50 years, our job is cut out for us. We've got to feed about 4 billion more people than we're properly feeding today. We will do it. Your role is incredibly important. A little bit about the price of grain. This is kind of interesting. How many expect corn to go below $4 in the next 2 years? Raise your hand. About 2% of you. It's a fair estimate. How many expect it to go below $4.50? Okay, this is a very optimistic crowd. And well, you should be. I was giving a talk at the University of Missouri a few months ago. And there was an ag economist that ran a company buying and selling puts. He had a consulting newsletter. And he actually predicted that corn would go down to $3.50 or even $3. And I followed him on the podium and I said to him, in front of 500 people, I'll bet you $1,000 that in the next 2 years, corn will not drop below $4 for a period of 30 days, period. I had him between a rock and a hard place. He had no choice but to jump up and accept my bet. And I'm looking forward to collecting his $1,000. And what I explained to the group is that China buys the bulk of our soy. They buy almost none of our corn. They, when the price for corn begins falling well below 5 for a period of time, China will jump into the market. And if it gets to 4, they'll become a major buyer. So I put my money where my optimism is. That doesn't mean life will ever be easy for you economically, but the future is indeed very bright. But our primary problems are the misunderstandings of agriculture. So I'm going to just start feeding you a lot of information that you can share in your 2 hours a month for the rest of your lives. And when I say the rest of your lives, I really, really mean it. How many of you are nearing retirement or thinking about retirement? Raise your hand. A guy with 2 hands over here, we got to talk to him right afterwards. How many other hands on the right side of the room? A few. Hey, disabuse yourself of that terrible idea. Retirement really sucks. If you love what you're doing and you're recognized for what you do, why would you want to give it up? Now, I can understand buying more time for yourself, reducing your responsibility, reducing your income on the farm, maybe working for your kids. I know that's a horrible idea, but, you know, working for your kids. But retirement really does suck. I know very few people who have successfully retired. I mean, they lie and they tell you they're happy doing whatever it is they're doing, but they're not near as happy as what they were doing. And I can't wait to talk to the guy with the two arms that went up. He obviously hates what he does. I'm sitting on a plane one day, a few years ago, and there are two people behind me across the aisle from each other, and they hadn't seen each other in a while, and the guy on one side of the aisle's name was Tom, and the other guy's name was Bob, and Tom said to Bob, Bob, are you still with XYZ Company? And Bob said, yeah, but only for 9 months, 9 years, 3 months, and 17 days more. Is that pathetic and sad? I mean, that's maybe the saddest comment I've ever heard. Well, none of you are in that spot. You love what you do. If you don't, you should get out of it. And one of the things you need to do with your kids is talk about how much you love farming at the dinner table instead of how annoyed you are at the price of corn or the rain or the drought or whatever the hell is making life tough for you. Because that's what's been driving young people away from the farm. But less so today than it used to be, and I will explain that to you in detail. My clock. You know, I'm never overtime. When I started speaking professionally, I went to a speaking consultant. And the guy was a total ass. And he told me all the things I didn't want to hear, like tape every one of your talks and listen to the audience every 15 seconds. And if you don't get a good response, change the words. Oh, my God. I've never given the same talk twice and never will. But at the end of a boring 2 days, he gave me one good piece of information. He said, carry a big clock and never go overtime. Because no one ever walked out of a speech saying, wow, that was great, I just wish it was longer. So I carry a big clock, and it stopped, and I'm going to reset it here so I don't go overtime. Okay, the kind of misinformation we want to begin rolling back deals with the age of farmers, the number of farms, the size of farms, and a few other things. So let me tell you about the American farm. In 1935, we had 6.7 million farms. By 1975, we were down to 2.16 million farms. We still have 2 million farms. In the last 30, 40 years, since 1975, we've only lost a few ten thousands of farms. And it goes up and down by decades. We're not losing farms. We're not losing farmland. Small farmers are not going out of business. Now, all of our farms in America are divided up into two groups by an 85 to 15% rule. 15% of our farms produce 85% of our output. 85% of our farms produce 15% of our output. You're likely all in the 15% group. Don't know that for sure. But the 80-20 rule works in every business. No matter what the profession is, 20% of the businesses do 80% of the business. But the small farms in America are incredibly important because that 15% output is important to American agriculture, and it allows us to have an incredible infrastructure of farm service organizations throughout our nation. Another next myth is that we're no longer family farms. Raise your hand if your farm is owned by a major Wall Street corporation. Well, I'll be darned. I don't see a hand. 98% of the American farms are still owned by families. 90% are individual, family-owned. 6% are family partnerships. 2% are family corporations, and the last 2% are owned by giant absentee corporations who are big and they produce 6% of our output, but 94% is produced by the family farm. set the public straight. We are really no different, other than far more advanced. We don't have hobby farms. We don't have corporate farms, significantly. We don't have factory farms. Boy, there's an ugly word. How many of you raise hogs or cows or chickens? Just a handful of you, but you know, the anti-agriculture people try to teach the public that farmers abuse their animals. What a stupid idea. You think you can get more eggs by abusing your chickens, more milk by abusing a cow, more lean meat by abusing a hog or a steer? We want to make money off our animals. We got to treat them better than our children. And most of us do. But it's in vogue to teach the public that farmers don't treat their animals well. It's really stupid. So they came up with this term factory farm, you know, raising animals in a factory. That's not the way it works. I had an interesting experience with my wife a few years ago. And Janet's here with me. I was visiting, consulting with an egg farm, and I spent 3 hours with 140,000 chickens. And I came home and I said, Janet, you'd be amazed, but I just spent the afternoon with 140,000 chickens and it didn't smell any different than our living room. Now, you understood what I meant. She didn't. And I didn't dig out of it. I said, honey, if you can take the day off tomorrow, we'll bicycle up to the egg farm. It was only 35 miles away, and I'll get a tour for you. And, of course, we did, and she got a tour, and she understood totally that this farm was so well run, there was no odor, and the chickens were well cared for, and so on. But we've got to get rid of these myths. Now, there are five rules that I want you to share. In fact, there are just two words I want you to remember before I get into the more technological aspect of my talk. I want you to remember two words, farm rule. Farm rule. The F in farm stands for farm inputs. The R stands for recycling our inputs. The U stands for we got to use modern farming techniques. The L is for land conservation, and the E is for environmental stewardship, and I'll go over them briefly. The public does not understand what N, P, and K is. They don't realize that nitrogen, phosphate, and potassium are to a plant what fat, protein, and carbohydrates are to a human. The plant can't live without them. These are natural things. We mine phosphate and potassium from the ground and give it to our plants. We extract nitrogen from the air. As I said, the public thinks fertilizers are nefarious things. You've got a project in Iowa to reduce inputs. God, I don't know who overuses fertilizer. The damn stuff is expensive. But we have a major project of reducing fertilizer use, getting into the Mississippi, more for just showing the public that we care. I don't know who overuses pesticides, fertilizers, insecticides. They cost too much money. But people need to understand that pesticides and insecticides are plant medicines. They are the same as medicines to you. Without them, the plants die. We've got to get rid of the pests and the diseases that kill our plants. So people, very simply, need to know what these things are. They've got to understand that we are recycling our fertilizer in every year because they go to market. N, P, and K go to market with our grains. Half the country is deficient in phosphate and potassium. So they have to understand we're just recycling. In fact, you're farming here in the Midwest because we didn't understand agronomy when we came to this country, and we farmed on the East Coast and didn't know about adding N, P, and K, so we sterilized the soil and we moved from the East Coast on into Pennsylvania and Ohio. We screwed that soil up, and we moved on into Indiana and Illinois. Next, we came here, and sadly, we didn't learn our lesson till we got to the West Coast. Isn't that a shame? Wouldn't it be better if there were no West Coast? So you need to explain about our inputs. You need to explain that if we didn't use these inputs, people would starve. They use basically organic farming, low yield farming in Africa, and that's where they do starve. I mean, there's nothing wrong with organic farming if you're smart enough to get away with it and sell your product for a lot more money, but the yields are half what our yields are, and we can't feed the world. We got to double our output, not have it. It's a nice niche, but we must use modern farming techniques to feed the world. And the L in farm rule stands for land conservations. You heard me putting my head in the window of the cars on Lombard Street in San Francisco saying that if we didn't have modern fertilizer, we'd be farming Golden Gate Park. And it's true. You golfers and kid parents of soccer players and nature walkers, you owe it all to modern agriculture, because we would be farming more land if it wasn't for our farm inputs. We are the best land conservationists. We're not eating up more and more land. We farm less land and produce more output today than we did 40 years ago. Absolutely amazing. I'm telling you this to tell others. This is going to be the central theme of some of your conversations, 2 hours a month. More if you'd like, to educate the public about farming. And E stands for environmental stewardship. Tell me, somebody in this audience, what day does America celebrate Earth Day? What's the date? Anybody? April 22nd. Good. Few of you know it. I hope all of you know the day that farmers celebrate Earth Day. What day is that? Thank you. Share it with the public. We drink water from our wells. We breathe the air. We protect our soil. We're the best environmental stewards, but there are groups out there trying to undermine us, scare people about our fertilizer and our pesticides, trying to get people to be all organic growers, trying to get people to be vegans. God, does anybody here know a healthy vegan? Yeah, I'm still looking, too. I don't know if you don't know what an Ironman triathlon is. I've been doing it forever. I'm almost an original. You need a strong body and a very weak mind. And you jump into some ocean, generally an ocean, but it could be a lake. And you swim 2.4 miles. And then you crawl out of the lake, and you jump on a bicycle, and you ride 112 miles on your bicycle. And then you get off the bicycle and you run a marathon, 26.2 miles. Without a couple steaks every week, there ain't no way I could do that. There is no way anybody I know can do that. There was a prominent NFL football player that decided to go vegan, and my God, he got a hell of a lot of publicity for the full 6 weeks he lasted. Share these things. Okay. I want to get into the modern technology of farming. Well, one other myth is how old we are. I'm looking around at this audience, and you're looking really good to me. About 10 years ago, the average age of a farmer was about 55. The average age in this room is nowhere near as old as 55. I travel the 50 states. I count my audiences, and it's plunging. I was in North Dakota 4 times last year, and my average audience of farmers was 42. Just for the fun of it, raise your hand if you're in your 20s. 30s, 40s, 50s. Still a lot of you, but you'll be gone soon. Of course, I never want you to be gone. I want you to be farming when you're my age and well beyond. But it's dropping. And it's dropping because young people are realizing farming is exciting. They're playing video games, and all of a sudden they find out their dad is farming with a GPS, with a rotosteer tractor. He's no longer looking at his farm as a monolithic piece of ground that produces the same output across all the acreage, but he realizes at the very least he has a high yield area, low yield area, medium yield area, and he could map it on a computer, and as he goes over the ground putting in inputs, he can vary those inputs where he is geographically. There's a video game that's like this. It's called Farmville. Farmville has been one of the two or three most popular video games in the last 5 years. It's a free game on Facebook. And you play it against your friends. The idea is to see how much grain or animals you can produce. Well, in order to produce a lot of grain and animals, you got to buy farm equipment, you got to buy food, you got to buy seeds. And you actually pay a company called Zynga real money for imaginary seeds. Hey, Wyffels would do really great if they charged you money and gave you an empty bag. What a theory. And yet there are people dumb enough to do this, and it's a popular game. Well, agriculture is more exciting than a stupid video game, and I don't mean to insult the few of you that play it. Talk about this kind of agriculture. How many of you are using a GPS to run your farm? Raise your hand. You're about right at 40%. That's where we are nationally. Those of you who aren't, you'll be there in 5 years. 100% of, essentially, of American agriculture will use some form of precision agriculture, auto-steer, GPS, looking at their acreage and separating into zones of high, medium, and low yield, or maybe even more precise with more soil sampling. All right, here's a really important question for you. How many of you own a tablet computer? Raise your hands very high if you own a tablet computer. Okay. When does this meeting end? What time do we end here? 2:30. Well, I hope the rest of you will have bought one by 4 o'clock this afternoon. You cannot possibly run a farm as efficiently as you might if you don't own an iPad, and sadly, it has to be an iPad. Not that I work for Apple or care. Those of you who own a tablet, and it's not an Apple, an iPad, give it away and buy an iPad. And the reason I say this, and I'm not joking, and you don't have to buy one by 4, tomorrow will be fine. There are currently well over 300 applications for agriculture on an iPad. You go to the Apple Store and you punch in agriculture, and over 300 icons will pop up on your tablet screen. It'll take you 4 hours minimum to peruse them, and in that period, you will come up with a half a dozen that will make your life easy, or whether it's about how you spray an insecticide, or how you map your land, or how you keep spreadsheets, or how you keep instantaneous data on the prices of your inputs and outputs. It is physically impossible for you not to find 4 to 6 apps that are going to make your life easier. Now, there are still a handful of you that hate computers, hate smartphones, and all that jazz. I don't blame you. I think they're ruining the world, but we can't live without them. Wouldn't it be neat if we could untether our kids from these horrible electronic machines and get them out to play, talk on the phone instead of tech? When I was a kid, and a few of the older people here, we would have loved to get our kids off the phone. Now we'd love to get our kids on the phone. They don't talk anymore. They only text. But we all need an iPad to run a farm. I only figured this out about 4 years ago. I was at an irrigation conference in that town in Missouri where they have a lot of hillbilly shows, Branson, Missouri. And I'm going to speak after lunch, and there was a buffet lunch, and I sat down at a round table with a half a dozen farmers, and one farmer was telling another farmer about his really cool computer application that ran all his irrigation operation. He had a whole bunch of center pivots, and he ran them all from his iPad from far away, and he could measure the soil moisture and rainfall input, and he could set the irrigation systems to go on and off. And I said to him, wow, where did you buy that app? He said, I didn't buy it, I made it. I said, you have a degree in computer science? He said, of course not. I just figured it out myself. And I realized that, you know, here was a young man that had figured out how to use computer technology to his benefit, saving him a great deal of time and money. And I really got in then to study the apps that were available, and it's just been growing by leaps and bounds. So you are going to get into it. But more than that, I want you to talk about it. You'll snow people if you're involved in precision agriculture or you are using a computer app, recognizing that we're doing this in modern agriculture. People are fascinated. Few of you are operating your grandfather's farm. Okay, most of you, almost everyone here, is using a genetically modified seed. So let me give you a tutorial on biotechnology, which I want you to share. You all generally understand it. Most of you are buying Wyffels great, you know, genetically modified corn seeds. But let me give you a little knowledge from the beginning that probably will be new to you. Two guys named Francis Crick and James Watson discovered the DNA molecule in England, London, in 1953. It was the secret of life, the recipe of life. In 1972, two California scientists were able to recognize genes on a DNA molecule, which were recipes for traits in living things. By the end of the 80s, we began experimenting with improved foods. And one of our first improvements was to find a strawberry that would withstand an early frost. And there was a fish up in the Arctic called the Arctic flounder that would freeze in the ice in the winter and then thaw out and swim away in the spring. And they figured there must be a gene in this fish that protected it from structurally being destroyed when frozen. So they went up and they got 1,000 embryos of Arctic flounder, and they looked at the DNA, and they looked at genes that might be the gene that protected it from being destroyed upon freezing. So they would pluck out the gene, let it grow up to a fish, freeze the fish, thaw the fish. If the fish swam away, they had plucked out the wrong gene. They did this hundreds and hundreds of times until one day, they plucked out a gene from the DNA of the embryo. The embryo grew into a fish. They froze the fish. They thawed the fish, and it was dead. They decided they may have found the gene. They repeated the experiment hundreds of times till they knew they had the right gene. They then transferred that gene into the strawberry and were able to drop the freezing or frosting point of the strawberry from 32 degrees down to 28 degrees, and we call it the frost-free strawberry. That is exactly what genetic modification is. We look at one life form that has a trait that we wish was in another life form, and all genes are transferable from plants to animals to humans. Gene is a gene and a gene. We share 5,000 genes with our own corn. I don't mean that as an insult, it's just the way it is. So we study life forms, and we find traits that we wish were in our corn and our soy and our wheat and our vegetables and all the other things. We try to isolate the genes that code for these traits, and we move them. In the old days, we crossbred things by guess and by golly. We would grow a short red carnation, and we'd have a tall white carnation. We wanted a tall red, so we'd crossbreed the carnations. Mostly, we got a medium pink. One day, by guess and by golly, we got a tall red. That was hybridization of yesteryear. We still do it. Wyffels still does it. But now we can do it with laser precision through genetic modification, finding the traits, transferring the genes, and making sure they work out. And it's 100% safe because the laws of US EPA, Food and Drug Administration, US Department of Agriculture, the hoops we have to jump through to qualify for a new food are so rigorous. The public need never worry. Not a single human being has ever been made ill by a genetically modified food. Share that with the public. Nothing to be scared about. And finally, in technology, reduced tillage. We're eliminating erosion. We're improving soil moisture in our soil by reducing our tillage. Many of you, how many, raise your hand if you're into no-till. A goodly number, probably 20%. It's sweeping the country. There are few places in America that we cannot effectively reduce tillage. And by doing so, and share this, by reducing tillage, we reduce fuel, wear and tear on our machinery, our labor, fumes in the air. We improve soil tilth after a couple of years, improve soil moisture, eliminate the runoff of any of our inputs. We create a habitat for critters that run around underneath it. The only thing I have a problem with, well, the only real argument against reduced or no-till is the fields don't look as pretty. You know, I'll admit that. But my other problem with reduced tillage is that environmental zealots favor it. And anytime I agree with them, I worry. Maybe I'm wrong. But it is the wave of the future, and you need to share these things. Well, some more information that you will find useful. Raise your hand if you're worried about land prices. Wow, this is a smart audience. And I don't mean to insult those that raised their hand. But you need not worry. What state has agricultural land sold for its highest price? Altogether, Iowa. But you got to know about that sale of land. As I recall, the land went for about $20,000 an acre, and it was an auction, and two farmers got in a fight with each other. They hated each other, and by God, you're not going to get those 65 acres. And they bid it up to $20,000. And that's really all of the high land prices across America. Really crazy prices. Are auctions where somebody by damn wanted that land regardless of the price. How much land do you think changes hands in Iowa in a year? Percentage-wise, yell out a number. I'm hearing 10%. Will somebody tell me lower? 4 is the right answer. So land prices are meaningless. If only 4% changes hands, the prices are meaningless. We don't have a land bubble. We don't have a land bubble for a couple of reasons. Number one, there's not a lot of credit in our land purchases, so we don't have a credit bubble. There isn't much land changes hands. I would say at best, if we have accurate averages of land prices, you know, we could see about a 10% reduction. I don't even expect that. But you don't need to worry about land prices. Ethanol is a problem. We grow a lot of corn for ethanol in this state. Ethanol is going to be around at least till 2022 because the law says that we've got to produce 36 billion gallons of biofuel by 2022. This was a law promoted by the military that wanted to be sure that they could fill their planes, trucks, and ships with homegrown fuel. It was really unnecessary. We're now awash in fuel, which I'll explain in a moment. But we're not going to be, you know, ethanol is going to be around. We don't really need ethanol. If it disappeared, the price of corn would probably drop 75 cents to a dollar. But that isn't going to happen for a decade. And I wouldn't worry too much about it one side or another. If you have an investment in an ethanol plant, you might hang on to it. If somebody's trying to sell you one, you might not buy it. But we are awash in energy. I have been involved in fracking oil wells for 60 years, starting in Texas. There has never been a case of groundwater pollution fracking an oil well. Now, you may think fracking is new because all of a sudden we're horizontally drilling into shale layers, pumping up water to a high pressure, putting in round sand grains and a few chemicals that women use in their lipstick called a long-chain fatty alcohol. And we open up these layers and we get oil and gas out. We've been doing it for 60 years in the oil fields, but in vertical wells, you know, where you really opened up maybe a 200-foot seam back a few hundred feet into the formation. It was a value. But since we invented horizontal drilling, we could drill a mile out into a small shale layer and fracture it a mile out and many feet away from the horizontal hole, and small quantities of gas and oil pour in. We are awash in it. 100% of our shale gas and oil is produced on private land because the government isn't yet willing to do it, but we have enough private land and shale on it to make us the richest energy country in the world, really today, but recognized within 3 years. Other countries have every bit as much as we do, but in every other country but America, the mineral rights are owned by the country. And so they have this bureaucratic lag of getting going. I mean, eventually, within a decade, other countries will develop a lot of their shale gas, and the world will know they're awash in oil, and I think you can look forward to $2 or $2.50 a gallon gasoline. I don't know. I left home, it was $3.27. We're not going to use natural gas in our cars, but we're going to use it exclusively in our buses, our taxis, our trucks. Any place that goes to a central location at night where they have the service capacity for putting, you know, natural gas into your vehicle will do it. We will not build an infrastructure that will allow you to fill up with natural gas at your service station. But the future in energy is incredibly bright. Two negatives before I end. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency is always a negative. Their goal is to inhibit progress in America. Anything they're for, battle, though it's hard. People are getting fed up. One never knows what rules they will come down with that will inhibit agriculture, but you know some of them. You know, we don't need them anymore. Our state environmental protection agencies do a much better job. Our president, sadly, is a wholly owned subsidiary of EPA and the environmental groups that own EPA. It's a battle which will go on for, I'm afraid, for our lifetime. One final point, I don't have time to go into with you, but you all have two documents in front of you. One is my business card, and you have it for the serious reason of, I want you to feel free to contact me by email or phone absolutely anytime to ask any question. On the back of that card, are my 10 favorite reasons why man has virtually nothing whatever to do with the temperature of the planet. Global warming is one of the bigger scams, if not the biggest, ever perpetrated on society. It's all about money. Did I hear some applause? I'd love more. The amount of carbon dioxide we pump into the atmosphere has virtually nothing to do. The planet's temperature of the planet's been steady for the last 17 years, and yet the amount of CO2 that we pump in has increased. And in fact, as we look historically, we have 900,000 years of ice cores, and we can measure from gas bubbles in the ice cores what the actual temperature of the planet was when the ice was formed. We know that increases in the Earth's temperature lead increases in CO2, not CO2 increases lead temperature. And the reason for that is that when the Earth warms, the oceans cannot hold as much carbon dioxide as they did before. So as the ocean warms, carbon dioxide comes out. And so we can see century lags between increases in planetary temperature and CO2. All of you know that carbon dioxide comes out of warm sodas because every one of you has left an open can of Coke on your sink after drinking a little bit of it. And when you went back to drink it, it was flat. If you're interested in the 10 reasons of why we have nothing to do with the Earth's temperature, you can email me and I'll send you 38 more. It's one of my favorite things. But it's got a life of its own, and the academics get about $5 billion in research money, and people that hate agriculture, industry, capitalism, they love restrictions of carbon dioxide because it's a restriction on energy and a restriction on progress, essentially. And you need to be outspoken about those things. Finally, the other postcard, which is a self-mailer. I'm the science director of the Heartland Institute. We exist for one purpose, and that's to provide information, objective information on a wide variety of topics to elected state officials, every elected state official in America, to the 362 largest city mayors and their city councils. And we put out 7 free newspaper publications that come out, I think, 10 or 11 months a year. They're on environment and climate and agriculture. They're on healthcare. They're on school reform. They're on budget and tax. They're on information technology. And if you want any or all of these publications free of charge, you just check the box and throw the postcard in the mailbox. And you can get me through Heartland. Their website, heartland.org, is the best source of virtually any information on any of these subjects. And I hope you'll take an opportunity to look at it. You can find hundreds of my publications on the website. All right, I'm right on schedule. We've got a few minutes for questions and before we close down. So do we have a microphone for questioners? Okay. Anybody raise their hand loud if you've got a burning question you'd like me to deal with. And it could be about anything at all. And if there are none, that's okay too. I have filled your head with an awful lot of information. I'll be here for a little bit longer afterwards, and I'm going on to a newspaper office somewhere around Iowa City to try to talk some anti-agricultural editors into understanding why they need to be pro-ag in this fabulous state. You have been in a